من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدى هدى محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار الحمد لله We praise Allah, we seek His assistance, and we seek His forgiveness. And we seek refuge in Allah from the evil within ourselves and from our bad deeds. Whoever Allah guides, there is none that can lead him astray. And whoever is led astray, then there is no guide for him. I bear witness that there is no God, no deity, no object of worship, worthy of worship, has the right to be worshipped, is worshipped in truth, other than Allah. He is alone and has no partners. And I bear witness that Muhammad is his slave and his messenger. O you who believe, fear Allah as you ought to be feared, and don't die except as Muslims. O humanity, fear your Lord who created you from a single soul, and created from that soul its mate, and scattered from them too many men and women. And fear Allah for whom you demand your mutual rights, and don't cut off relations with the wounds that bore you. Indeed, Allah is a raqib over you. O you who believe, fear Allah, and speak correctly for that which is correct in order that you may have your sins forgiven and your deeds accepted and whoever obeys Allah and His Messenger has achieved the greatest achievement. Amma ba'du. Certainly the most truthful speech is the Book of Allah and the finest guidance is the guidance of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the most evil of affairs are newly invented matters in this religion and every newly invented matter in this religion is a bid'ah. And every bid'ah is a strain, and every strain is in the hellfire. Many times, when we come to our classes nowadays, walillahi alhamd, we hear the person who begins to give his talk, he begins with what you have just heard. And that is known as al-khutbatul haja. And this is what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to teach his companions to say before they had to present whatever they had to present to the people. And the scholars of the past, they used to begin their lessons and their books and their marriages and whatever khutbah or whatever talk or lesson that they had to present to the people, they would begin it with this khutbatul haja. Unfortunately, over the years, this khutbatul haja has become something that was only written in the collections of hadith of the Messenger of Allah, Muhammad ibn Abdullah ibn Abdul Muttalib ibn Hisham al-Qurashi al-Adnani sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. However, by the blessings of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala on us nowadays, then from the hard work of the Shaykh Muhammad Nasir al-Din al-Albani, they brought back and revised this sunnah that was becoming Allah's sunnah of using the khutbatul haja before the lessons and the lectures and so on. So today, inshallah ta'ala, as we are back in Philly once again, we wanted to make today's lesson an explanation of this khutbatul haja. This khutbatul haja that we begin saying, Inna alhamdulillah, nahmaduhu. Certainly the praise is to Allah or for Allah or however they translate it. We praise Him. This statement, Alhamdulillah, or we praise Allah, is one of the finest statements that a person could let come off of his tongue. As we know that the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says an authentic hadith collected by Al-Hakim in his Mustadrik, أَفْضَلُ الْقُرْآنِ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ, that the best part of the Qur'an is الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ, or that verse الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ, or referring to the surah Al-Fatiha as a whole, which is known as الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. The Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also says in another authentic hadith collected by Imam Ahmad, أفضل الكلام سبحان الله والحمد لله ولا إله إلا الله والله أكبر. In this hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us that the best type of speech is the statement سبحان الله والحمد لله ولا إله إلا الله والله أكبر. And these are statements that everyone knows. And they are, as the Prophet, who doesn't speak on his own desires, he only speaks from revelation revealed to him, tells us these are the best statements. أفضل الكلام سبحان الله والحمد لله ولا إله إلا الله والله أكبر. That's collected by Imam Ahmad. And this is the statement that the Prophet صلوات الله وسلامه عليه was using when he began this خطبة الحاجة. إن الحمد لله نحمده. The Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in another authentic hadith collected by Tirmidhi and An-Nasa'i and other than those two and their collections of hadith, he says, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi, afdalu al-zikri, la ilaha illallah, wa afdalu al-du'a, alhamdulillah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in this hadith says that the best type of zikr is the statement, la ilaha illallah. And it should be, because the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in another hadith, مَنْ كَانَ آخُرُ كَلَامِهِ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ دَخَلَ الْجَنَّةِ. And I think that this narration is in Sahih Muslim, where the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, whoever has his last speech of this world, being the phrase لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ, enters Jannah. Just as he says in another narration, من قال لا إله إلا الله خالصا من قلبه دخل الجنة. And whoever says لا إله إلا الله sincerely in his heart, enters Jannah. The best zikr or remembrance of Allah is the statement لا إله إلا الله. And the best type of dua is الحمد لله. The statement الحمد لله. And we know والحمد لله that dua is in two forms. One form is praising Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, and the other form, which is the well-known form of asking Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala for the good of this world and the good of the hereafter and to save us from the hellfire. So alhamdulillah is the best type of dua. And dua is praise and asking. Praising Allah and asking Allah, both of them are dua. And this is why the Prophet salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi is telling us here, the best type of dua is alhamdulillah. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran, in Surah Yunus, verse number 10, after I say, A'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajeem, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala tells us, wa akhiru da'wahum anilhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. That their last da'wah, or their last call or statement, and this is referring to the people entering to Jannah, will be an alhamdulillah rabbil alameen. So this statement alhamdulillah and alhamdulillah rabbil alameen that we find all throughout the Quran, that great phrase, this is the phrase that the Prophet salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi began this khutbatul hajah off with, just as Allah himself tabarak wa ta'ala began off his greatest surah, the most often recited verses in the Quran, Surah Al-Fatiha, with Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Inna alhamdulillah nahmaduhu wa nasta'inahu. Wa nasta'inahu, and we seek his assistance. when we see, yeah, and we seek his assistance. This statement, and we seek his assistance, is one of the most often repeated dua on the tongues of all of the Muslims, as we say in Surah Al-Fatiha, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. When we say Surah Al-Fatiha, and we know that it is divided into two sections, half of it for Allah and half of it for us. The first part up to إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ is all about praising Allah تبارك وتعالى. And then from إِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ on down is asking Allah تبارك وتعالى. This إِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ, or you alone do we seek assistance. And as we have said in خُطْبَةُ الْحَاجَةِ نَسْتَعِينَهُ, and we seek his assistance. This is what Allah تبارك وتعالى teaches us to say in all of our salawat. In each rak'ah and our salah, that we're constantly asking Allah for his help. وَاللَّهُ الْمُسْتَعَانِ. And maybe some of you have heard the statement, وَاللَّهُ الْمُسْتَعَانِ, and it also comes in the Qur'an in a few places, that Allah is the one that we seek his help. And that is very important to be on the tongues of the Muslims in the salah and out of the salah, seeking Allah's help. And especially if we want to do something like, we want to present our class, or our lecture, or our talk, or whatever we like to present to the people, we should begin with seeking the assistance of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us to say in this khutbah al-hajj. Just as Allah tabarak wa ta'ala teaches us in our salah to have that iyyaka nasta'in, that we seek the assistance of Allah. And this is, and it can't be more emphasized, to show that each and every one of us, we're just like Allah says, وَخُلِقَ الْإِنسَانُ ضَعِيفًا, and human beings have been created weak. And we need the assistance of Allah تبارك وتعالى, because without Allah's assistance, where will we be? Where would someone be if his Lord تبارك وتعالى didn't help him?
That's
right. If Allah abandoned you, left you alone, you'll be blindly wandering on. We have to see the importance of asking Allah تبارك وتعالى for his assistance. As he says, صلوات الله وسلامه عليه, إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره. And we seek his forgiveness. ونستغفره. And we seek his forgiveness. We're seeking forgiveness just as seeking assistance, just as praising Allah تبارك وتعالى should always be on our tongue, as the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us in an authentic hadith which has been collected by Imam al-Bukhari, a Muslim, and other than those two in the authentic collections. Wallahi inni la astaghfirullaha wa atubu ilayhi fil yawmi 70 marra. The Prophet of Allah Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us, I swear by Allah, and he wants to show the importance of this, and this is a point that we see in many places in the Quran, and we see in many of the hadith of the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I swear by Allah, as this is a phrase in Arabic, wallahi, that the Arabs used to use to show the severity or the importance of what they're about to mention. Wallahi, I swear by Allah that I seek Allah's forgiveness and I repent to him more than 70 times in a day. And in the narration of Imam Muslim, 100 marra, more than 100 times in a day. If that's the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the one who has his past and future sins forgiven, the one who is the finest of mankind, the master of the children of Adam, or the Sayyidu Walidi Adam, if he used to seek Allah's forgiveness more than 100 times a day, how much more should we be seeking the forgiveness of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala? Knowing that Allah tells us in the Quran, in Surah Al-Nahl, verse number 61, وَلَوْ يُؤَاخِذُ اللَّهُ النَّاسَ بِظُلْمِهِمْ مَا تَرَكَ عَلَيْهَا مِنْ دَابَّةِ. That if Allah were to hold the people accountable for the wrongdoing that they did, there will be no one left walking or crawling on this earth. If Allah were to hold us to account for the wrong that we did, and nobody has to shout out the wrong that he did, but if he looks in the mirror, or if he looks at his life, then he knows the wrong that he's done, or that he's doing, astaghfirullah. And that if Allah were to hold us to account for that wrongdoing, we'd all be finished. So it's very important for all of us to do just what the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is teaching us to do, and that is to seek His forgiveness. Constantly and always. In this khutbatul hajah that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi had taught us to present before the lessons that we present, or whatever we have to present to the people, He's teaching us this guidance, this thing that we need to be on daily, and that we should remind ourselves of these things before we want to present something else to the people. ونستغفر and we seek His forgiveness. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره. Indeed, or Alhamdulillah, we praise Him, we seek His assistance, and we seek forgiveness in Him, or we seek His forgiveness. ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. And we seek refuge in Allah from our evil deeds and from the evil that's within ourselves. And the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who has been given the Jawami' al-Kalam, we see that when he makes a statement that it is all-encompassing. We seek refuge in Allah from the evil that is in ourselves and from our evil deeds. However you look at that evil, inner and your thoughts in yourself, behind closed doors, that which no one sees, and the evil of the deeds that you do, we seek refuge in Allah from that evil. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us and protect us from falling into the evil, that which is in ourselves, that which Allah tabarak wa ta'ala tells us about in Surah Al-Yusuf, وَمَا أُبَرِّئُ نَفْسِي إِنَّ النَّفْسَ لَأَمَّارَةٌ بِالسُّوءِ إِلَّا مَا رَحِمَ رَبِّي إِنَّ رَبِّي غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in this verse in Surah to Yusuf, verse number 53, and I don't free myself from the blame. Certainly the soul is inclined to do evil except when my Lord shows His mercy on it. And indeed my Lord is Ghafoor Rahim, forgiving and merciful. Verse number 53, so to use. We're all inclined to do evil, to do that wrong. And Shaytan, alayhi la'natullah, is always encouraging us to do wrong. As he's running through our bodies, just like blood runs through our bodies, as the Prophet of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, has told us in an authentic hadith. We're inclined to do that evil, and for that, we seek refuge in Allah, tabaraka wa ta'ala, from that evil within ourselves and our bad deeds. The Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us to seek refuge in Allah from all evil things. And in here, we said that he was using his comprehensive statements to cover everything that we could possibly do or want to do that's wrong. And in other hadith, the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had detailed it out, as he says in one of the famous isti'adha, اللهم إني أعوذ بك من علم لا ينفع ومن قلب لا يخشع ومن نفس لا تشبع ومن دعاء لا يسمع. Oh Allah, I seek refuge in You from knowledge that doesn't benefit, from a heart that doesn't have any fear of Allah or humbleness of Allah in Allah, to Allah. From a desire, from a soul that's never satisfied, and from having dua that's never answered. The Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in this isti'adha is mentioning four of the things, the evil that a person can have in his soul, of having knowledge that doesn't benefit. You're an engineer, you're a carpenter, you're a computer scientist, you're whatever, from the knowledge of this world. You don't know anything about this deen. Maybe you're not even a Muslim. Knowing that the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has told us in authentic hadith, selected by Imam al-Hakim, not in his Mustadrik but in his Tarikh. إِنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى يُبْغِضُ كُلَّ عَالِمًا بِالدُّنْيَا جَاهِلٌ بِالْآخِرَةِ. That Allah Ta'ala hates everyone who is knowledgeable of the affairs of this world, ignorant of the affairs of the hereafter. You have knowledge that won't benefit you. If that knowledge don't get you to Jannah, it ain't benefit you. وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنْسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. And I have not created the jinn nor the mankind except to worship me. If you got knowledge that won't help you fulfill your purpose in life of worshiping Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, then you have a knowledge that won't benefit you. Or if you have a knowledge that you won't work by, that knowledge won't benefit you. I know. Akhi, you know about that? You know about this? You know about that? Yeah, I know riba is haram. I know usury is haram, but I'm weak. Knowledge that won't benefit. Knowledge that won't benefit. It's an evil thing for a person to have some knowledge that won't benefit him. And this is why the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is teaching us to seek refuge in Allah. Firstly, from all of the evil within ourselves and from all our bad deeds. And then he's being specific in this hadith, as he has in many hadith, from knowledge that doesn't benefit. From a heart that doesn't fear Allah. Arrogant. Hear the commandments of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, don't want to act upon them. Hear the prohibitions and continue doing them. A heart that just doesn't fear Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. From a soul that's never satisfied. No matter how much of this beautiful, sweet dunya he gets, and this dunya sweet. And we were just talking about it on the way up. When you look at that dunya, you walk outside, you see a Mercedes Benz, you see them alligator shoes. You see, whatever you see it is beautiful, do you see all of them green trees, those big beautiful houses? Who don't want it when he sees it? If he get it, just keep wanting more, and more, and more, and more, until you're never satisfied. We should seek refuge in Allah tabarak wa ta'ala from that soul that's never satisfied. Everything he sees, he wants. And the more he gets, the more he wants, because he's never satisfied. We should seek refuge in Allah tabarak wa ta'ala from a soul that's never satisfied. Alaykum as-salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Na'am.
If you get a wife, is she considered part of the dunya, or is she considered part of the dunya to her? Or your child considered part of the dunya?
Baby from among those things of the dunya, a wife. And the man for her. We know that the Prophet from Allah alayhi wa sallam says that الدُّنْيَا مَتَاعُ وَخَيْرُ الْمَتَاعُ وَخَيْرُ مَتَاعِ الدُّنْيَا إِمْرَأَةٌ صَالِحَةٌ أَوْ كَمَا قَالَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ وَصَحْبِهِ وَسَلَّمَ. That the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم is saying that this dunya is a commodity, and that the best commodity of this dunya is a righteous lady. So yes, a righteous lady is a part of that. But we don't want to drift off the subject in saying that we seek refuge in Allah from the evil of constantly wanting and never being satisfied. And I was just mentioning that when I was coming up, I had that nafs. Well, alhamdulillah that Allah has saved me from it, and I constantly seek refuge in Allah from a soul that's never been satisfied. When I came up, I was known as ungrateful. He never satisfied. Whatever you give him, he want more. I used to say, yeah. All of this, why can't I have it? Give me that, I want another one. Give me another one, I want another one. Another one come out better, I want that one too. And more and more and more. And you see us, even after our Islam, it hasn't changed. We just keep wanting and wanting and wanting. Like we were just saying today, how many Muslims can stand up proudly and say, I only have 3 outfits in my closet? Proudly stand up and say, I only got 3 outfits in my closet. One for this day, one for the next day, one for the next day, repeat. How many people can proudly stand up and say they got 3? And the Prophet of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, had less than that. We can't even proudly stand up and say we got 3. And the Prophet of Allah, Muhammad ibn Abdullah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the finest example for humanity, had less than that. We got souls that just can't stop wanting. And we should seek refuge in Allah from that, like we should seek refuge in Allah from a dua that's not answered. Making dua to Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, and he don't answer that dua. Oh Allah, give me Jannah. He won't give you Jannah. We should seek refuge in Allah from a dua that's not answered. And we should also be mindful to take the means, the halal permissible means, to live our lives so as to tread that path that we would have our dua answered by Allah tabaraka ta'ala. Because how can you expect your dua to be answered? Your food is haram, your drink is haram, all of your nutrition is haram, and you want Allah tabaraka ta'ala to answer your dua? The Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us to seek refuge in him from all of the evils. And Imam al-Nasa'i rahimahullah, in his book which is known as the Sunan al-Nasa'i that many people quote from, he has a chapter in there called Al-Isti'adha, where he takes all of the hadith or a group of the hadith on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam where he's seeking refuge in Allah from it. And one of my brothers in Islam from Trinidad, Omar Salim, he had begun translating that, and inshallah ta'ala, if he ever finishes or if he sends us a copy, we'll be sure to give it to the brothers. But I just wrote down some of those things that the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to seek refuge in Allah from. We just gave an example of these four because they just seem very important to me. And I like to say that dua in order that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save me from that evil. But the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to seek refuge in Allah from being a coward, from stinginess, from being sad, from laziness, from weakness in general, from poverty, from bad character, from being in debt, from the hellfire, from the Masih al-Dajjal, from the punishment of the grave, from the fitna of this life, from the fitna of our lives and of our death. The Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to seek refuge in Allah, used to seek refuge in Allah, used to seek refuge in Allah from all of the evil within ourselves and from our bad deeds, as he detailed in that chapter from Imam al-Nasa'i on al-Isti'adha. Now,
what's the sin of poverty?
Allah knows best. Inna alhamdulillah, nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruh wa na'udhu billahi min shururi anfusina wa min sayyi'ati a'malina. Man yahdihillahu fala mudilla lah wa man yudlil fala hadiya lah. Certainly the praises to Allah. We praise Him, we seek His assistance, we seek His forgiveness, and we seek refuge in Allah from the evil within ourselves and from our bad deeds. Whoever Allah guides, there is none that can lead Him astray, and whoever is led astray, then there is no guide for Him. There are many, many verses in the Quran that explain or that say the same thing that the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying in this khutbatul hajjah, when he says, whoever Allah guides, there is none that can lead him astray, and whoever is led astray, then there is no guide for him. As Allah tabarak wa ta'ala says in the beginning of Surah Ibrahim, verse number 4, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ رَسُولٍ إِلَّا بِلِسَانِ قَوْمِهِ لِيُبَيِّنَ لَهُمْ فَيُضِلُّ اللَّهُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ وَيَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ وَهُوَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ. And we have not sent a messenger except in the language of his people in order that he may explain to them. Allah tabaraka ta'ala, out of his wisdom, and we're going to get back to the point, have chosen messengers from the people in order that they may make things clear to them. They're from them, they speak their language, they know what's happening, they bring Allah's message to that people. Let's not be fooled like some of the people from among ourselves were fooled in the past, thinking that that meant we needed a messenger to the African Americans here in the United States. Who's our messenger? Our messenger is everybody's messenger after the time of Muhammad ibn Abdullah ibn Abdul Muttalib ibn Hisham sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. After him, he's the messenger for everyone. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells him in the Quran to tell humanity, قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ إِنِّي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ إِلَيْكُمْ جَمِيعًا. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala tells Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, our prophet and our messenger, the last prophet and messenger to humanity, say, I command you to say, O humanity, I am the messenger of Allah to all of you. and the Messenger of Allah to all of you. And the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in authentic hadith in Tirmidhi, La Nabiya Ba'di wa La Rasul. There is no Prophet after me, nor a messenger. There is no Prophet after me, nor a messenger. So Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the last final messenger. But Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala is just showing the wisdom of having a person to bring the message to a people, and he's in the language of that people. Like Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, alhamdulillah, has allowed me to come before my people and to explain what I know of Islam to them in the language that they understand. And everybody after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, from wherever he was in the earth, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed from among those people to learn the language of Islam, Arabic, to learn the Quran and the Sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then to relay that back to their people. And that this is wise and this is proper and this ain't got nothing to do with racism. That a person from among a people teaches them as opposed to someone else, this is the Sunnah of Allah. وَلَن تَجِدَ لِسُنَّةِ اللَّهِ تَبْدِيلًا. This is the way of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, and you don't find any changing in the way of Allah unless we try to go about it and do our own thing. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala goes on to say, for Allah will lead astray whoever He pleases, and He will guide whoever He pleases, and He is Al-Aziz Al-Hakim. Al-Aziz, the Mighty, Al-Hakim, the Wise. So Allah is telling us here in this verse, just as He's telling us in verse 27 of the same surah, that He guides whoever He pleases, and He leads astray whoever He pleases. And that it's nice to remind ourselves of this statement when we're presenting something to the people. Because whoever presents something to the people, he hopes that the people will accept what he's bringing to them. He wants them to accept what he's saying. Matter of fact, he won't accept that anything other than accepting from him what he's bringing to the people. Why would he stand up to the people? Except that he wants the people to accept what he's bringing to them. But that it's not in our hands, it's in the hands of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. He guides whoever he pleases, and he leads astray whoever he pleases. إِنَّكَ لَا تَحْدِي مَنْ إِنَّكَ لَا تَهْدِي مَنْ أَحْبَبْتَ وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ يَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ. Indeed, you don't guide who you please, who you love, but Allah guides whoever He wishes, whoever He wills. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala tells us in this next verse, we'll skip that, verse number 27, but whoever wants to see it, they could. And go to Surah Al-Ghafir, number 40, verse number 34, where Allah tabarak wa ta'ala says, كذلك يضل الله من هو مسرف مرتاب. That is how, this is the end of the verse. That is how Allah leads astray everyone who is extravagant, murtab. I need a translation for that. I forgot my Muslim. Yeah.
Doubt
him.
That leads astray.
Yeah. Everyone who is a transgressor and a doubter, Allah leads them astray. And the reason I chose this, and this is also the same thing that was in the verse, so to Ibrahim, where Allah is just saying He leads astray. Allah leads people astray if He wants to. Allah is Al-Hakim, the wise, Al-Alim, the knower. And if He chooses to lead somebody astray, then He leads them astray. And it ain't on us to guide and lead astray, but that's on Allah. And in America, sometimes people feel that it's not fair to prevent somebody from something. But Allah tabarak wa ta'ala does what He wants. And if He wants to prevent someone from being guided, then that person will just be prevented from being guided, and Allah is just. And Allah is not unjust to His servants, as He tells us in many verses in the Quran. Allah is not unjust to us, but we're unjust to ourselves. That we want to be led astray, and we go astray, and Allah leads us astray. Just as He tells us in the same Surah Al-Ghafir, verse number 74, Allah says, ك وَكَذَٰلِكَ يُضِلُّ اللَّهُ الْكَافِرِينَ. And this is how Allah leads astray the kuffar. Those disbelieving kuffar, those mushrikeen, and every mushrik is a kafir, and every kafir is a mushrik. Allah leads them astray. There's no need for us to want some disbelieving mushrik kafir to go to Jannah, like unfortunately some of the Muslims I hear are saying today. Why do you want a disbeliever to go to Jannah when Allah has prepared that fire for the disbelieving people? Why do you want them to go to Jannah except that America is pushing this thing of humanity? They're a human being. He's a human being. You want a human being to be burnt in the fire? What kind of compassion do you have? What kind of generosity do you have? What type of understanding do you have to want another fellow human being to be burnt in the fire? Look at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who shows us of His oneness and His science. Today we were just looking, we picked up something on the side of the road we used to play with when I was young. I don't know the name of it. But it's like hard as a rock and it's brown. It grows on like a long type of grass or something. Anyway, if you break it up, it comes into soft feathers like.
A big soft
feather?
Yeah. Top part?
Yeah.
Okay.
Anyway, we're saying, subhanAllah, one type of soil, one type of water that comes from the sky, you get that. You get grass, you get weeds, you get poison ivy, you get apple trees, orange trees, on and on and on and on and on. You can't say how much come out of the ground. Walnut trees or whatever. Almonds, cashews, everything coming from the ground, corn. One water, one soil, all of that for humanity to enjoy. For one little price. Just worship me. Don't ascribe any partners to me. They reject Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala after He's allowing them to enjoy all of that of His creation, and then they reject worshiping Him, ascribing partners to Him. Do they think that Allah is unfair at giving Him the fire as a reward? He wakes up every day, he can see, he can hear, he can taste, he can smell, and on and on and off of the bounties of Allah. وَإِن تَعُدُّوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تَحْصُوهَا. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, if you were to count the blessings of Allah, you couldn't count them. You couldn't count the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on us. All He wants is us to worship Him. Don't ascribe any partners to Him. No matter how much wrong you do, Allah forgive you. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَن يُشْرَكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَن يَشَاءُ. That Allah, wastaghfirullah, if I was quoting this verse improperly.
Yeah. You know, he went to the Masjid al-Aqsa. Yes.
Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is telling us in this verse that Allah doesn't forgive that you ascribe partners to Him, but He forgives anything outside of that to whoever He will. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala can forgive anything we do. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is ready to forgive us from saying astaghfirullah. Oh Allah, I seek your forgiveness for whatever wrong we do, and we incline to do evil, and Allah is ready to forgive us, and He told us He's going to forgive us, and He will forgive us inshallah ta'ala. All He wants from us is to worship Him and don't ascribe any partners to Him, and we ascribe partners to Him. Wallahi, Allah is an unjust when He gives the fire. And a lot of times since I've been back from Medina, when I look out there and I look at them disbelievers, when I look at the mushrik, I say, wallahi, Allah is just at giving him that punishment He said He's going to give them. The punishment that we seek Allah, refuge in Allah from. And we seek refuge in Allah from the fire. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, when I look at them and see how blindly wandering they are doing, how they're just going astray after Allah has given them all of this. And especially in these days and time where Islam is being spread openly, you have the chance to hear it, think about it, and accept it, and you reject it, and you're saying how Allah leads them astray. He ain't fair for leading them astray. Why don't He give them a chance? Give them a chance to let them wake up. He gave them eyes they can see, ears they can hear, tongue they can talk, water that they can drink. If He wanted to, He could have made that water ujaja. As He says in Surah Al-Waqi'ah, أَفَرَأَيْتُمُ الْمَاءَ الَّذِي تَشْرَبُونَ أَأَنْتُمْ أَنْزَلْتُمُوهُ مِنَ الْمُزْنِ أَمْ نَحْنُ الْمُنْزِلُونَ لَوْ نَشَاءُ جَعَلْنَاهُ أُجَاجًا فَلَوْلَا تَشْكُرُونَ. Don't you see that water that you drink? Did you bring it down from the sky, or did we bring it down? If we had pleased, we could have made it ujaja, salt water. The more you drink, the thirstier you get until you dehydrate. Won't you be thankful? Won't you be thankful? They don't show no thanks to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Is Allah unfair at leading them astray? Is Allah unfair when He says that He has prepared for them the hellfire? Allah guides whoever He pleases and leads astray whoever He pleases. Don't try to let our mind, because of this American lifestyle, let us think that there's some impartialness in this, or that it's not being fair, guiding some, leading some astray. They led astray by what their hands did. They got eyes, they don't see. Ears, they don't hear. An intellect, they don't reason. Deaf, dumb, and blind, they don't understand.
No. Is it wrong for us to feel sorry for them because they don't see this? Like, be pitiful towards them.
The brother is asking, should we feel sorry for them or show pity for them because they don't understand? The Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had to reveal this verse in Surah Yusuf to show him that no matter how much pity you show for them, this is in Allah's hands. And this is verse number 103. وَمَا أَكْثَرُ النَّاسِ وَلَوْ حَرَصْتَ بِمُؤْمِنِينَ. Most of the people, no matter how eager you were to guide them, just won't believe. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah presented him with the chance of destroying all of the people or giving them a chance to believe. He called them to the Tawheed, they rejected it. Allah said, look, I'll destroy him, finish off all of them. Or you want me to let them go? The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, rahmatan lil alameen, the mercy to all the world, said, let them go. Because he showed pity and mercy on them. Even when they died, the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to seek forgiveness to him. And Omar radiallahu anhu used to pull the coat of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, for lack of better terminology. How are you going to seek forgiveness for them? They die on that stuff. They have a chance to believe like us, they die on kufr. How can you seek forgiveness for them? The Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, out of his eagerness for the people to be guided, out of his mercy and his love and his compassion and the pity that he showed for the people to be guided, he wanted to even seek forgiveness for them after their death. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala showed us in Surah At-Tawbah that it's not proper that you seek forgiveness for people that have been made clear to you that they are from the people of the hellfire. And we can only know that after a person dies on kufr. If someone dies on kufr, case closed. Case closed. He's out of it, don't seek no forgiveness for him. For so long as a person is living, then we should have the compassion and the pity to want those people to be guided. Just like after this guidance that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with, walhamdulillah, alladhi hadana lihada, wa ma kunna linahtadiya lawla an hadana Allah. Alhamdulillah, who has guided us to this, and if it wasn't that He guided us to this, we would have never been guided. After Allah has showed His mercy on us, to allow other people to show their pity for us and their mercy for us and their compassion for us and be patient with us and give their time to us to guide us to Islam by Allah's permission, how can we not have pity for our people who we see that are going astray until it has been made to us that they are from the people of the hellfire? Allah tabarak wa ta'ala in Surah An-Nahl, verse number 94, and also showing this point. We had a lot of verses, but I think we'll just quote a few of them and try to keep it short.
وَلَوْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ لَجَعَلَكُمْ أُمَّةً وَاحِدَةً وَلَكِنْ يُضِلُّ.
All of you one nation. Meaning, He would have made all of you believers in Allah. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala al-Aziz, Al-Qawi, Al-Mateen. If He had pleased, Al-Ahad, Al-Wahid. If He had pleased, He could have made all of us believers. All of us to accept this Tawheed and to live our lives according to it, just as He tells us in the Quran. If He had pleased, He could have made it like that. But Allah goes on to say, or on the contrary, Allah will lead astray. Rather, on the contrary, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, rather, Allah, or He, referring to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, leads astray whoever He pleases, and guides whoever He pleases, and you will be certainly questioned about what you do. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of His wisdom. And He does whatever He pleases. And He's not questioned, but we're going to be questioned about what we do. Allah is in question. Oh Allah, why did you allow one water to grow so many things from one soil? Allah is not questioned about what He did. Oh Allah, why did you guide him and lead him astray? Oh Allah, why did you make him die on Iman and him die on Kufr? Allah is in question, but we're going to be questioned about what we did. And you will be questioned about what you do. When we're going out to call the people to what we're calling them to teach the people whatever we want to teach them, we have to know that the tawfiq or the hadaya, the success or this guidance is in the hands of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala alone. He guides whoever He pleases and He leads astray whoever He pleases, and it's on us to be concerned about what we do. We call the people and then we be concerned about what we do. Because each and every one of us are going to have to stand in front of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala naked, uncircumcised and barefoot, only having our deeds to account for us. If they're good, we'll go over that sirat or the bridge over the hellfire. And if they're bad, nasallahu alayhi wa sallam. We ask Allah to see. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Kahf, verse number 17, tells us, مَنْ يَهْدِ اللَّهُ فَهُوَ الْمُهْتَدِ وَمَنْ يُضْلِلْ فَلَنْ تَجِدَ لَهُ وَلِيًّا مُرْشَدًا. Whoever Allah guides, then He is guided. And whoever is led astray, then you won't find any helper or guide. Or guide. And that's what Allah subhanahu, that's what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is telling us in this khutbatul hajj. Once Allah has given you guidance, you guide it. And once Allah leads you astray, ain't nobody that can guide you. That's the bottom line. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He wants us to call humanity to this truth. ادعوا إلى سبيل ربك بالحكمة والموعظة الحسنة وجادلهم بالتي هي أحسن. And I command you to call to the path of your Lord بالحكمة. And the حكمة is the sunnah or wisdom. And good exhortation. And to argue the people in the best possible manner. Or with the best possible argument. This is a commandment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on us. We have to call the people. But when we call them, the tawfiq or their guidance is in the hands of Allah. Their guidance is in the hands of Allah. It's not in our hands. We have to know when we stand in front of the people, it's not on us that they accept what we bring. It's on us to deliver the message. It's on Allah to do what He pleases. And Allah guides whoever He pleases, and He leads astray whoever He pleases, just as He tells us in Surah Al-Isra, verse number 97. And this is the same as the verse that came before in Surah Al-Kahf. وَمَنْ يَهْدِ اللَّهُ فَهُوَ الْمُهْتَدِ وَمَنْ يُضْلِلْ فَلَنْ تَجِدَ لَهُمْ أَوْلِيَاءَ مِنْ دُونِهِ. That whoever Allah guides, then He is guided, and whoever is led astray, then you won't find any helpers for him besides Allah. You won't find any helpers for him, just as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in Surah Al-Ra'd. And I think we'll make these the last verses. InshaAllah, the point has been brought home that Allah guides wherever He pleases and He leads astray wherever He pleases, as He says.
وَيَقُولُ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا لَوْلَا أُنزِلَ عَلَيْهِ آيَةٌ مِّن رَّبِّهِ قُلْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُضِلُّ مَن يَشَاءُ وَيَهْدِي إِلَيْهِ مَن أَنَابَ.
And they and those people who disbelieve, those people who are kuffar, they say if only an ayah, a sign from their Lord would have been given to them, they would have believed. Say, Allah guides whoever He pleases, Allah leads astray whoever He pleases, and he guides to him whoever repents. In this verse, it reminds me that one time when I was giving da'wah to my wife's family, her mother said that her husband will believe. He's waiting for a sign. He's waiting for a sign. And a lot of people say that. You're trying to call them to the truth of Islam, they're waiting for some sign. I feel, or I sense it might be the truth, I'm waiting for a sign to convince me to show the truth of it. Allah leads astray whoever He pleases, and He guides to him whoever repents, whoever He pleases. Don't let someone say or think or feel or believe that he's waiting for a sign, and when that sign comes to him, he's going to give up that riba. What would make you realize that when the sign comes to you, you don't believe? Those people of Mecca, when the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was calling to them to this tawheed, they said, if you show us a sign, we'll believe. The moon was split in half, and they still disbelieved. The Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam performed miracle after miracle after miracle. They were brought sign after sign after sign, and they kept on disbelieving. This stuff on waiting for a sign to come to you, going to believe? I don't know who's so arrogant as to think that when that sign is going to come, he's going to believe. No one knows that. This guidance isn't in our hands. Your hands, my hands, or anybody else's hands. It's in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He will guide whoever He pleases and lead astray whoever He pleases. Just as He says in the same verse, in the same surah, except verse number 33. At the end of the verse, وَمَنْ يُضْلِلِ اللَّهُ فَمَا لَهُ مِنْ هَادٍ. And whoever Allah leads astray, there is no guide for him. We can go on and on and on to show that Allah guides whoever He pleases, and He leads astray whoever He pleases. And that we shouldn't be among the people who reject this basic thing. And the thing, and the reason why me personally, that I was pushing this issue of Allah guides whoever He pleases and leads astray whoever He pleases, and to keep reiterating it and reiterating it, is that sometimes because of this so-called democracy, this so-called majority rule, this so-called fairness, we can overlook the fact that Allah guides whoever He pleases and leads astray whoever He pleases. I remember when I was first going to college here in America, I was in a program, in a summer program, EOF program. They prepare you to get ready for the fall semester. We had two fads, homos, whatever you call them, in the program. I told them, what? Them boys better not speak to me. They say hi to me, they look at me, they mention my name to somebody else, and they come to me, I'm fighting them on the spot. I remember everybody saying, "A'udhu billah," like, who that brother think he is? Arrogant, out of place, streetwise, street-like, all of the stuff they used to say. If that's his personal preference, then what's the problem? He got a right to do this. And everybody was against me. Wasn't nobody in the whole program with me. You like that. I hate fags too. But if that's what they want to do, they ain't bothering nobody. They ain't calling you to it. They just peacefully coexisting with us. What's the problem? If you like vanilla ice cream, I like chocolate, I ain't got to fight you over that. I let you leave you with your own personal preference so long as it don't affect me. When you eat chocolate ice cream that I don't like, it don't hurt me. And when you do that thing you like, it don't bother me. It ain't in my house. You doing it. Sometimes we can get into that so-called liberalness that we don't think that this guidance is in the hands of Allah and that this leading astray is in the hands of Allah. It's in the hands of Allah, tabarak wa ta'ala. He guides whoever He pleases and He leads astray whoever He pleases. Guides whoever He pleases by His mercy, His generosity, and leads whoever He wants astray by His wisdom. Just as Allah tells us one last time, inshallah ta'ala, in Surah Al-Baqarah, verse number 26. Where Allah says, يُضِلُّ بِهِ كَثِيرًا وَيَهْدِي بِهِ كَثِيرًا وَمَا يُضِلُّ بِهِ إِلَّا الْفَاسِقُونَ. Allah says, and He leads many people astray by it, by the Quran. And He guides many people by it, by this Quran. When we call the people, we call the people to this book, to worship what's in this book. And many people are going to be led astray. We don't have to feel ashamed at calling the people to Islam by using the verses in the Quran. They don't believe in that. They don't believe in it. You got to give them some whatever, you know? Because they don't believe in it. How are you going to use a book that they don't believe in. We have to use the Quran and calling people to Islam. And then know that many people will be guided by it and many people will be led astray by it. And Allah leads astray the fasiqun by this book. Those people who are outside of the realm of obedience to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, those are the people that Allah will lead astray by this book. It's not that you're innocent, that you're righteous, that you're pure, that you're sanctified, and Allah leads you astray. Allah leads you astray. Look at what you're doing. Don't think that Allah ain't wise and who He guides and who He leads astray. Oh, look at that brother, man. He accepted Islam. Look how he acts. As if we're trying to say Allah ain't had no right to guide that brother because look how his Islam is. He would have been better off as a kafir. At least he ain't guilty when he could still commit that fornication, taking them drugs, indulging in that riba, and on and on and on and on from the characteristics of some of the bad Muslims. Allah guides who He knows deserves that guidance. And He leads astray who He knows deserves that being astray. We look at some of the older people, maybe our grandparents or whatever, and we look. Basically, they seem like God-fearing, law-abiding citizens. How could Allah lead them astray? You call her to Islam, your grandmother just won't accept. Man, she seemed to be so innocent. Seemed to be so kind. Seemed to be so good. I don't know why she won't accept the message. Something in that heart called a disease. Allah just sealed it with that disease, and they won't be guided. But Allah knows what's in that heart. If it's sincere, Allah will accept it. And if it ain't, He gonna reject it. But Allah guides whoever He pleases, and He leads astray whoever He pleases. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. And I bear witness that there is no God that has the right to be worshipped other than Allah. He is alone and has no partners. And I bear witness that Muhammad is His slave and His messenger. Here the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is bringing that shahadatain that brought us into Islam in his khutbah al-hajah. And this shahada tan is one of the five pillars of Islam, as the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us in authentic hadith, Bunya al-Islam ala al-khams. Shahadati an la ilaha illallah wa anna Muhammad Rasulullah. And that's the first pillar to the end of the hadith, that Islam is built on five. And the first is to bear witness to la ilaha illallah and that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. And that the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in another authentic hadith tells us that every talk is rejected until it has the tashahud in it. That every time we want to present something to the people and we don't proceed before what we present to the people with tashahud, and the tashahud is commonly known as ashadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah, and that is a useless speech or unacceptable speech or something like that. I'm forgetting the exact words. And in the narration, another narration, that's in general. In another narration, which is more specific, the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and I think this narration is in Abu Dawood, explains that the tashahud that you use before the speech that you're about to give, it is the khutbah al-hajah. As the Prophet ﷺ said, the tashahud in bringing that narration, and then afterwards he brought what we're explaining today, inshallah, as al-khutbah al-hajah. That tashahud that we bear witness that there's no deity, no object of worship that's worthy of worship or has the right to be worshipped other than Allah, and that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. This is the basis of this deen. That this deen is built on those two shahadas. And that those two shahadas, after we have accepted Islam, they follow us all throughout our Islam. As we have mentioned before in the past, that this Islam is based on two sources, not three, four, or whatever. And those two sources are the Quran and the Sunnah of the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Quran, the speech of Allah. The Sunnah of Muhammad ibn Abdullah, the Messenger of Allah. And that is the shahada, I bear witness that there is no deity to be worshipped in truth other than Allah. What do we mean when we bear witness to that fact? that we're going to obey Allah and that which He has commanded, and to stay away from that which He has prohibited. And we bear witness to the prophethood or the messengership of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then we're saying the same thing, that we're going to believe in what he brought to us, and we're going to obey him and follow him. This is what we're saying when we say, أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا وَحْدَهُ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ وَأَشْهَدُ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا عَبْدُهُ وَرَسُولُهُ. And if we were to go into it would be a lecture in itself, just showing the importance of belief in Allah and belief in His last Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and obeying Allah and obeying the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. No deed will be accepted from us until we have that shahada in place. Until we work in by that shahada, just as Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala tells us in the end of Surah Al-Kahf, verse number 110. فَمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُو لِقَاءَ رَبِّهِ فَلْيَعْمَلْ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا وَلَا يُشْرِكْ بِعِبَادَةِ رَبِّهِ أَحَدًا. Now whoever desires to meet his Lord, and let him do righteous deeds. Righteous deeds are those deeds in accordance with the deen of Allah. The deen of Allah was brought by Muhammad ibn Abdullah ibn Abdul Muttalib ibn Hisham sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Whoever desires to meet his Lord, then let him do righteous deeds, and not ascribe any partners in worship with his Lord. That means that every belief, every statement, every act of worship or deed must be done sincerely and solely for the sake of Allah, and in accordance with the deen of Allah, that which Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam brought to humanity. And the ulama explained that these conditions that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is setting forth in this ayat, that no belief, no statement, and no action will ever be accepted by Allah until they fulfill these two conditions. And if you have one of them in the absence of the other, then that deed is not qualified to be accepted in the sight of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, and that this is the fulfillment of the shahada. أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَأَشْهَدُ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدَ رَسُولُ اللَّهُ. We know that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala tells us فَرِيقٌ فِي الْجَنَّةِ وَفَرِيقٌ فِي السَّعِيرِ, that there are a group of people in Jannah and a group of people in the hellfire. And Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, He sends an angel to everyone when they're in the stomach of their, in the womb of their mothers, to write it down. شَقِيٌ أَوْ سَعِيدٌ. شَقِيٌ from the people of Jannah, سَعِيدٌ from the people of Jannah. When you're in the womb of your mother, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala have made for us living this life. It's all about the life that's going to come, a group of people in Jannah and a group of people in the hellfire. And Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, in the beginning of Surah An-Nisa, in verses 13 and 14, makes it very clear what is the path for the people to be in Jannah and what is the path for the people to be in the hellfire. As He says, تِلْكَ حُدُودُ اللَّهِ وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ يُدَخِلْهُ جَنَّاتٍ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارُ خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا وَذَلِكَ الْفَوْضُ الْعَظِيمُ وَمَنْ يَعْصِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ وَيَتَعَدَّ حُدُودَهُ يُدْخِلْهُ نَارٌ خَالِدًا فِيهَا وَلَهُ عَذَابٌ مُهِينٌ. 13 and 14, Surah An-Nisa. These are the boundaries of Allah. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala set it out and made it clear. Whoever obeys Allah and His Messenger, we will enter him into Jannah, gardens underneath which rivers flow, abiding therein forever, and that is the greatest achievement. And whoever disobeys Allah and His Messenger and transgresses the bounds, His bounds that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has set, then we will enter him into the hellfire, abiding therein forever, and that is a humiliating punishment. The fulfillment of this shahadatain, of getting to the Jannah and staying away from the hellfire, is all based on obeying Allah and disobeying Allah. If you obey Him, you get to His Jannah, and you disobey Him, you get to the hellfire, and that's the bottom line. You have been created to worship Allah. That is obeying Him and not disobeying Him. If you obey Him, you get to Jannah, and if you disobey Him, you get to the hellfire, and that's the bottom line. That's what life is all about. And when we call them the disbelievers to Islam, that's what we're calling them to. Ya ayyuhal kafirun, O you disbelievers, you have been created for a purpose. That purpose is to worship Allah. Worshipping Allah is obeying Him and staying away from disobeying Him. If you do so, if you obey Him and stay away from disobeying Him, you'll enter into Jannah. And if you don't, you disobey Him, and do what he tells you not to do, then you enter into the hellfire, and that's it. That's the main message that we're giving to these disbelievers. And that message that we're bringing to them, we're going to tell them when they accept Islam, inshallah ta'ala, that they have to make that shahadatain. And that shahadatain is said in the adhan, in the salat, on the minbar. And the virtues of the shahada, I mean, you can't say it anymore. This is Islam. This is what Islam is all based on. Just as Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala tells us in Surah Al-Hujurat, in the first ayah, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تُقَدِّمُوا بَيْنَ يَدَيِّ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهِ. O you who believe, don't decide an affair in your life. Don't do anything until you know the decision of Allah and His Messenger in that affair, and then fear Allah. And this is important. All of us know it, all of us hear it, but we got to make sure that this principle is practiced in our lives. This is the basis of that shahada. And this is why when we say something to people, we're going to have that shahada time in it, in order to remind ourselves that if we say something to the people, we want to make sure it's in accordance with what Allah and His Messenger brought. Whatever we say to the people, we want to make sure it's in accordance to what Allah and His Messenger brought in the Quran and the Sunnah. And we have to use this principle in our lives when we're not speaking to the people. But in general, we want to go into a business. We want to get a job. We want to buy something. We want to sell something. Whatever we want to do in our lives, before we make that step, we want to make sure that it's in accordance with the Quran and the Sunnah of Muhammad ibn Abdullah, the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is an easy statement. It's easy to understand, because this deen is easy and this deen is simple. We got to make sure that we constantly remind ourselves that whatever we want to do in our lives, that we shouldn't be decisive until we know the decision of Allah and the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in that affair. And I'm not bringing this example up to be against anybody, but today it was said, is this color from among the colors that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prohibited for the men? I'm not against anybody, and we're not trying to make fun of anybody or whatever, but we just want to show that even though it's on our tongue that we make mistakes in implementing this basic principle in Islam, that we don't do anything until we know the decision of Allah and His Messenger in it. Did I make a good purchase? It's too late. It's too late to ask that question after you did it. Before you do something, make sure you know the decision of Allah and His Messenger. وَلَا تُقَدِّمُوا بَيْنِ يَدَيِ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ. Don't just decide, then see, isn't in accordance with Islam. Akhi, I married a sister like this, was that right? Akhi, I did this, was that right? Akhi, I did that, was it right? If you want to know if something's right or wrong, find out before you do it. It's a basic principle, we all know it, we have to remind ourselves. And the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as we're saying in this khutbatul hajah, He's giving us guidance. He's reminding us. That person who's speaking, He's reminding him and the people of some principles that we have to keep in our lives daily, every day. And we have to make sure we don't transgress the bounds in living up to those principles. All the praises to Allah. We praise Him. We seek His assistance. We seek His forgiveness. We seek refuge in Allah from the evil within ourselves and from our bad deeds. Whoever Allah guides, there is none that can lead him astray. And whoever is led astray, then there is no guide for him. I bear witness that there is no deity, no God, no object of worship, worthy of worship, has the right to be worshipped, worshipped in truth, other than Allah. He is alone and has no partners. And I bear witness that Muhammad is His slave and His messenger. This is the beginning part of the khutbatul hajah. And these are principles that the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wants the speaker to remind himself of, and he wants the people to be reminded of these principles while they're listening to that which the person is about to present to them. And these principles, we have to keep them in our lives, and we have to remind ourselves constantly and always to live our Islam and according to this guidance of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. After that, the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam goes on to the rest of the khutbatul hajah. But because of the time, I just want to take a little break then inshallah ta'ala, we'll have a little something to drink, and then the brothers can get rested up, then we'll begin, if the brothers like, inshallah ta'ala. I ask Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala to forgive me of my sins, and to show His mercy on me, and to make that which I say correct. If I had said something that was incorrect, then it is from me, and I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive me, and to save you from falling into that which I have fell into. If there was anything good and right in what I said, then it's from Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم والحمد لله رب العالمين. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. O you who believe, fear Allah as He ought to be feared, and don't die except as Muslims. عبد الله ابن مسعود رضي الله تعالى عنه said, إذا سمعت الله تعالى يقول يا أيها الذين آمنوا فرعها سمعك فإنه خير يأمر به أو شر ينهى عنه. And that's from تفسير ابن أبي حاتم. عبد الله بن مسعود رضي الله تعالى عنه said, when any one of you hears the verse, hears Allah Ta'ala say, يا أيها الذين آمنوا, O you who believe, listen closely to that. Or make linear here, yeah, listen closely to it. Because it's some good that you're going to be commanded with, or it's some evil or bad that you're going to be prohibited. It's some good that you're going to be commanded with, and it's some, or some bad that you're going to be prohibited. So be sure to lend your ears to listen closely when you hear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, O you who believe, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu. And it comes in a lot of verses in the Quran. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu taqullah. يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا تقدموا بين يدي الله ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا أطيعوا الله وأطيعوا الرسول يا أيها الذين آمنوا يا أيها الذين آمنوا يا أيها الذين آمنوا إذا قمتم إلى الصلاة. When you hear that in the Quran or when you read that in the Quran, be sure to listen up closely, because it's some good Allah is going to command you with, or it's some evil He's going to prohibit you with. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته. اتقوا الله. Fear Allah. Imam al-Tabari, habibahu Allah, says in many places in his tafsir that to fear Allah is to make sure that you obey Him and stay away from disobeying Him. To make sure that you obey Him and to stay away from disobeying Him, and that this is the fear of Allah. When you hear Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala tell you to fear Allah, that means to obey Him and stay away from disobeying Him. To fear not to obey Him, and to fear disobeying Him, and that this is the fear of Allah, ittaqullah. And Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu, as far as the part, ittaqullah haqqa tuqatih. Fear Allah as He ought to be feared. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu says, fear Allah as He ought to be feared, to obey Him, and أن يطاع فلا يعصى. ويذكر فلا ينسى ويشكر فلا يكفر. And this is in Tafsir al-Tabri. To obey Him and don't disobey Him. To remember Him and don't forget Him. To thank Him and don't be ungrateful. To obey Him and don't disobey Him. To remember Him and don't forget Him. To thank Him and don't be ungrateful. This is fearing Allah as He ought to be feared, in the viewpoint of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, one of his companions, Amr ibn Maymun, said the same thing about the verse, and he didn't attribute it to Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. Amr ibn Maymun said that fearing Allah as He ought to be feared means to obey Him and don't disobey Him, to remember Him and don't forget Him, to thank Him and don't be ungrateful. Amr ibn Maymun is a companion of
Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, who is the companion of the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Here we see two people from the first two generations making the same statement on one ayah. And Amr ibn Maymun narrates a few things on Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And this is what we're trying to show here, how we work in accordance to the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, خَيْرٌ نَاسْ قَرْنِي ثُمَ الَّذِينَ يَلُونَهُمْ ثُمَ الَّذِينَ يَلُونَهُمْ. That the finest of mankind is my generation, then the one that came after them, then the one that came after them. In the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, تَتَفْتَرِقُ أُمَّتِي عَلَى ثَلَاثٍ وَسَبْعِينَ فِرْقَةٌ كُلَّهَا فِي النَّارِ إِلَّا وَاحِدَةٌ قِيلَ مَا الْوَاحِدَةُ قَالَ مَا أَنَا عَلَيْهِ الْيَوْمَ وَأَصْحَابِي. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, my ummah will be divided into 73 sects, all of them in the hellfire except one. It was said, and which one is that? He said, what I am adhering to today and my companion. Practicing of this, of these hadith, following our Salaf al-Saleh is coming, as we see, practically before our ears in this at Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who was one of the companions that said, I was present when 70 chapters of the Quran was revealed to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu was there. He heard it. He knew why it was revealed, concerning who, what was the meaning, the whole 9 yards on the ayah. Here he is explaining one of those ayahs from among the 70 chapters that he was present when it was revealed. One of his companions is explaining the same ayah with the same meaning. Sometimes on those earlier generations, you have them making statements, those ulama, not attributing what they say to the people who came before them, but because of their closeness to the people who came before them, trying not to deviate from that which came before them, you find that what they say is equivalent to what the people before them said, because they didn't say anything until they knew that the people before them said it. And this is what we say is when we follow the manhaj al-salafi, that we follow the righteous predecessors, we follow the methodology of the people that came before, starting with the Sahaba, how they practiced and understood this Quran and passed it on, and how they took that practice and understanding and passed it on and on and on to our generation. When we say that we're practicing it, this is an example from that, which is different from what we have today and what we want to discourage the brothers from doing. Many of us, and myself included, we don't know this deen. We know a little bit about this deen. But if somebody question us, bam, we're scholars. Start dropping it. What we should do is stop that. We're not Amr ibn Maymun, the companion of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, from among the best three generations. We're not some of the hufaz of this deen. Some of the memorizers of this deen, that they memorize so much of this deen that at times they don't say where they got it from, because they memorize everything from the people that came before them. So even if he didn't say where he got it from, it had come from somebody who came before him. But us, the people who don't memorize nothing, when we passing stuff on, we might be passing it on rightly and we might not, because we don't even memorize. And a lot of times, and I'm saying to me, and this is just my outlook, that many of us, we're not even getting it from the people who came before us. We got an ayat or a hadith or a statement, and we're going to run with it and defend it to the end. We don't have that knowledge, and Allah knows best, to be out there defending everything to the teeth. What has come to us, if it has the evidences, and it's clear that it's the truth, inshallah ta'ala, we learn it, memorize it, practice it, and then call the people to it. If the people come with an argument, and we don't know, we don't have the Arabic down, we haven't studied the Islam, we haven't looked into the books, there's no need of coming to arguing with the people about it. Like a brother came to me one day and said, I went to a masjid. They let me lead them in salah. I said, assalamu alaikum, one time. Everybody was shocked. What happened to the other salam? I told them, didn't y'all read the book by Muhammad Nasir bin al-Albani and had a hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that said he did it like that? They said, what? I ain't going with it. He said, I knew they wasn't going to take it because they only take what comes to their imam. I told him, first mistake, you knew they wasn't going to take something except they come from the imam. Why didn't you go to the imam first?
Do you like that the people disbelieve in Allah and His Messenger? And if you don't, then why didn't you go to the Imam first if you knew that the people wouldn't accept it unless it came from the Imam? We ain't stupid. We gotta have wisdom. This is Islam. We have to call the people to the truth in the best possible manner. If we know that it's more likely that they might accept something this way, we bring it that way. It's gonna hurt us to go out of our way to help our brother be guided when the people went out of their way to help us be guided by the permission of Allah. Secondly, I told him, if they didn't accept it, they ain't the only ones that accept it. You don't even know the issue behind it. You read Al-Bani's book, Hasabahullah, one of the finest books ever written on Salah, if it's not the finest book. But there's other stuff said too. And you don't go beating somebody down, breaking somebody down, saying somebody's wrong, because it seems clear to you, with your limited knowledge, that what you got is the truth. I told him, don't you know some scholars say the hadith is da'if? And among them is Al-Hafiz ibn Hajar, Al-Asqalani, Al-Hafiz. When you say the memorizer, they know you're talking about one man. When you say the memorizer, they say you're talking about one man. Al-Hafiz ibn Hajar, who wrote the explanation of Sahih al-Bukhari, who did such a good job that the ulama say, la hijrata ba'd al-fath. And that's a statement from Imam al-Shawkani, that there is no looking to another book after looking at Fathul al-Bari written by Al-Hafiz ibn Hajar al-Asqalani. And we were to look at all of the books he wrote, easy, we'll fill up a few bookshelves. The books that he wrote. He say, is da'if. Did you know that? No, I ain't know that. Then why are you acting like the people criminals? Maybe they went with him. They saw his argument. They saw that it was okay. They went with it. Right, wrong, whatever. We don't just attack our brothers like that. We don't be as if we're so knowledgeable as to be bringing the deen on that level. What we heard, we preach it to the people. Accept it, whoever accepts it. Reject it, whoever rejects it. But if somebody's coming to us to argue, bringing another proof, we don't know this deen, we standing up there to defend what? Be quiet. Go get the people who know to defend this deen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed men from among us and from other places to defend his deen. When he says, Inna nahnu nazzalna zikr wa inna lahu lahabidun, and certainly we have revealed to you the zikr, the revelation, and we are his preservers, Allah has preserved this deen in the hearts of men. He has given men the intelligence to hold this deen and to pass it on. We know we ain't them people that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose to be passing this deen on in that capacity. We need to be quiet. بَلِّغُ عَنِّي وَلَوْ آيَةً, as the Prophet ﷺ says. Preach on me, even if it's one piece of information. We preach that information. If people come back to us, we know we ain't on a level to be arguing and to be defending something that we don't have the knowledge of. We gotta let it go, because we might don't even have the knowledge of it. Just like the ulama used to say in the past, whoever does not know different of opinion of the scholars in Islam, he is not to be considered knowledgeable. How many issues come to us, we don't know the difference? Almost every issue. Almost every issue, except a few issues we beat people down with regularly. Allah is above his throne. Some people saying Allah is everywhere. We got it down, beat the people down. As if we don't know that there's scholars in Islam respected who have the same position. Allah is everywhere. Like Imam al-Nawawi, rahimahullah, wa ghafar Allahu lahu. May Allah show his mercy on him and forgive him of his shortcomings. And forgive us if we transgress. And make us correct in what we say. Ameen. Imam al-Nawawi, how are we going to say, because he made a mistake, didn't say Allah was everywhere, though he knew, he said Allah was everywhere, and didn't say that Allah was high above his throne, and not everywhere. He knew both sides. He's Imam al-Nawawi, rahimahullah, one of the greatest scholars that set on the face of the earth, who has books also that can fill up shelves. Books as fine as Al-Azkar, his book on remembrance of Allah, so fine that the scholars say, sell your house and buy that book, because your house ain't going to benefit you if you don't got that book. Shelter that keeps you from the elements. If you don't have that book, what that shelter going to do for you? Books that are so great, like his Majmu', that they say if he would have finished it, it would have been no book on the face of the earth as great as that book. Imam Nawawi, he makes a mistake. When he makes that mistake, do we put him out of Islam? Do we call him an innovator? A mubtadi'? No, we ain't call him no mubtadi', we ain't call him no innovator. Why when our brother in the masjid, down the street, or wherever, he say Allah is everywhere, first thing we do is take him outside of Islam. First thing we do is call him a mubtadi'. First thing we do is call him this, that, and on and on and on. Beating him down. Don't we know he in a land where people don't know? Where people don't understand? The people bringing him the truth don't understand. And he don't understand. We have to be careful, and we just wanted to mention this point, that we don't be among those people who go too far in spreading this deed. Meaning that we spread according to our knowledge. If we don't have the knowledge to be defending and backing up things because we don't have the Arabic language and we don't have, and we're not well read and we're not knowledgeable of the differences of opinions of the scholars and the evidences why each scholar went each way, then we need to let it go. Pass what we know on to be the truth and then be quiet and let the people who know deal with it. And this, we can't emphasize it enough to myself and to the brothers, that people when they ask a question, they never heard the question before ever asked. They go back into their memory bank, they figure out an ayat or two, they start answering it. Why are you dealing with something you never heard nobody who knows deal with it before you want to deal with it? You that knowledgeable? You of that level where when anything comes to you, you go into your memory bank and deal with it the best way you could? This is Islam. People don't go out talking what they don't know. Yeah, we might got an ayat or two, and it might seem like it applies to that. Or this hadith applies to that. Or that one applies to that. Do you have any knowledgeable people from among the scholars who see the same thing that you see? Who taught you, who groomed you, who raised you up to a level where you can see it like that? Then why are we going out acting like that? Everybody coming to us asking us questions we never heard, we dealing with it. Yeah, akhi, I think that means this. Yeah, you doing that? You can't do that. Don't you know Allah says this? Don't you know the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says that? We gotta have an understanding of this deen, and we gotta be on a level before we pass it on. And we don't wanna confuse it with spreading this deen. It's incumbent upon each and every one of us to spread this deen. Spreading the Quran and the Sunnah, and that's the deen. On the understanding and the practical application of the people who came before, starting with the Sahaba on down. We're supposed to spread it and pass it on. But when it comes with dealing with stuff we don't know, we haven't learned, and we know that we're not well grounded and we're not, we need to leave that stuff alone. And don't worry about it. When somebody says, you can't answer it, we got people who are better than us, that came before us, that there's no doubt about their scholarship, like Imam Malik, rahimahullah. Came to him, he didn't answer. If you don't answer, who can answer? You're the most knowledgeable man. If you don't deal with it, who's going to deal with it?